Now I'm going to talk about distance between mutually reachable Petrinet configurations. Yes, I put a nice picture. Maybe some of you know that it's an old game, a good old game. And I think it's a good logo for FSTTCS this year. So Petrinet is a model of concurrency. And mathematically, it's a very simple model. It's given as a finite set of what we call actions, which are pair of vectors of natural numbers. And this model, usually, it's not just given this way. There is a graphical representation of Petrinet. So I provide you an example of such a representation. So assume that you have a Petrinet where the dimension is free and you have four actions given this way. Then you can draw a picture of that Petrinet that will be a bipartite graph. You will have some nodes that will be between one and the dimension. So in your case, we have three nodes that are labeled by P1, P2, and P3. Usually, those nodes are called places for a Petrinet. And you also have nodes corresponding to the actions. Here you have A1, A2, A3, and A4. And those values, in fact, correspond to input edges from places to actions and output edges for the other part from actions to places. So as you can see, since I have a 2 over there, I will put a 2 at that position and so on. So this is a model of a Petrinet. There is a lot of many applications in logic, databases. Petrinet are also used to model many different systems. I will not discuss about that. I will directly move to the semantics of a Petrinet, which is given as a labeled transition system. So meaning that the semantics is given as usual as an infinite graph where the nodes correspond to the configuration of your system. In our case, for a Petrinet, it's a vector of natural numbers. Labels are just the actions of the Petrinet. And the transition relation is given as follows. You can move from a configuration X to a configuration Y using the action A, where A is the pair of vectors UV. If X is larger than or equal component by component to U, and the new configuration Y is obtained from X just by removing that vector U that you check again, and then you add V. Okay, so for instance, if I would like to draw the graph starting the labeled transition system, the reachable part of the transition system starting from the configuration 110, which is usually denoted that way. So you say you have one token in the place P1, one token in P2 corresponding to the 2-1 in that configuration, and zero token in the place P3. Then you can execute A3. Because A3, the first component of A3 is removing one from P1, removing one from P2, and adding two on P3. So the configuration you obtain in that case is 0, 0, and 2. And you can continue that way and you get a graph. In that case, the graph is finite. But in general, when you look at the reachable part of your graph starting from a configuration, it can be infinite. So for Petrinet, there is a central problem, meaning that many problems reduced to that problem is the reachability problem. So meaning, in that graph, you provide two configurations, an initial one and a final one. Does there exist a path that leads the initial one to the final one? So the reachability problem was proved to be exponential space hard by Lipton in 1976. And then, 4 years later, it was proved to be decidable by Mayer. The proof was improved, or the algorithm, the presentation of the algorithm was improved by Kozarajou 1 year later and by Lambert 10 years later. And nowadays, we call the algorithm the KLM algorithm with respect to the corresponding authors. And but this is not, so there is an algorithm for deciding the reachability problem, but there is also another one, a very simple algorithm, but it's based on an enumerative technique that I introduced in 2009. So the main idea is a very simple concept when you want to decide the reachability problem. The usual difficult case is when a configuration is not reachable. Because when the configuration is reachable, you have a witness of reachability just by providing a path. But when a configuration is not reachable, usually you need an inductive invariant that explains why this configuration is not reachable. And in that paper in 2009, I proved that thanks to this algorithm, by inspecting the way this algorithm is executed, we can extract an inductive invariant in the Presburger arithmetic. So meaning we can define linear inequalities somehow over a set of configurations that provide an inductive invariant proving that a configuration is not reachable. So the first proof was based on this algorithm. And then in 2012, I provide a new proof, completely new proof, just based on well quasi-order, on execution in the Lablet transition system associated to a PetriNet. Okay. So there is a simple algorithm, but at that point the complexity was not known of the reachability problem. With Sylvain Schmidt, we worked on that problem and we started to provide a computational complexity of this algorithm in 2015. And then very recently, at LIX this year, we showed that in fact the reachability problem, by modifying this algorithm and by modifying also the ranking function that explains why the algorithm is terminating, we prove with Sylvain that the reachability problem is easy for Ackermann complexity. So it seems that it's quite high, but it's an important result because when the reachability set of a PetriNet is finite, we can easily prove that this set is contains at most an Ackermannian number of configurations. Okay, so when the reachability set is finite, like in my previous example, you can just enumerate all the possible configurations, reachable ones, and decide if your configuration is reachable or not in Ackermannian time, because the size is at most Ackermannian. But in fact, it was not known if this result is still old for when the reachability set can be infinite. And with Sylvain, we proved that it's the case. In fact, we can decide the reachability problem in Ackermannian time or space is the same. And also recently, we improved the lower bound, the exponential space lower bound, to the tower complexity. So it means that the reachability problem, is non-elementary. So it's a very difficult problem, but hopefully, on some problems, I mean in logic, automata, or something like that, when you want to use a reachability problem for PetriNet, maybe it's not exactly the reachability problem you are looking for. You are looking for something weaker. And this is I will provide you several examples of the case where, in fact, what you really need is the mutual reachability problem. Meaning that you provide two configurations, and the question is, does there exist a way to move from one configuration to the other and come back to the original one? So naturally, this problem can be solved with the reachability problem. Okay, you provide the two pairs. But if you do that, you will get a tower complexity. For this problem. But in fact, if you do in another way, you can get a better complexity. So just to come back to the mutual reachability problem, so it's equivalent to say if you provide two configurations, if they are in the same strongly connected component of the reachability graph. So for instance, if you look at this example, my running example, and the Lablet transition system associated to this example, you can see that those configurations are in the same strongly connected component, and those are not. They are in different components. The mutual reachability problem means that when you want to move from a configuration to another one, and you want to come back, it means that every action that you perform along the run is reversible somehow. Okay, when you do an action, it's always possible to reverse the effect of this action. So naturally, if you do A2, you can do A3, A1, and come back to this configuration. But for PetriNet, it's not so simple we cannot classify action into reversible and irreversible ones. If you look at this example, naturally, A4 is always irreversible. We remove two from that place, and so the number that we provide strictly decreases somehow. But if you see A1, for instance, A1 is reversible from that configuration, but it's irreversible from that configuration. Okay, so the problem, the mutual reachability problem, cannot be reduced by just removing irreversible actions. Okay, so Just one important remark to motivate the state of the art. So the mutual reachability problem was proved to be decidable in 1977, just because if you look at the reachability relation, the mutual reachability relation, it's a congruence relation over the natural numbers with the addition, so it is semi-linear, and in particular, you can prove that the reachability problem is decidable in this general context. The mutual reachability problem for cyclic Petri nets, meaning that every action is reversible, which is not the case in general, so meaning that for every action, you have another action that performs the converse. It was proved to be exponential space decidable in 1997, and recently at Concur, yes? Structurally cyclic. It means that for every action, you have another action that do the converse. So if you, from the mathematical point of view of PetriNet, it means that when you have a pair of vectors, you have also the pair where you reverse input and output.
Yes. This is the definition of reversible.
Reversible.
It means that every pair of markings is reachable.
Every pair of markings. It's not structurally, it's okay. So it's a little bit more powerful, this result. Yeah. But it cannot be applied on this kind of PetriNet. And in Concur, I proved that, in fact, the mutual reachability problem, in general, is exponential space complete. Okay. And the idea is to prove that if two configurations are mutually reachable, there exist short runs that provide a witness of reachability. This mutual reachability result was used in several applications for PetriNet, but also for, we will see, for other models. So for instance, with Grégoire Sut and Pravin, we proved that we can introduce, thanks to the mutual reachability problem, we can introduce a logic over the traces of a PetriNet that is decidable in exponential space. And such that this logic provides a uniform way to express properties like this place is unbounded, or those two places are simultaneously unbounded, or the language accepted, the language of actions starting from an initial configuration is regular or context-free. All those problems can be described with simple formula in that logic that is decidable in exponential space. With Javier Esparza, Pierre Ganti, and Rupak Majumdar, we also prove that the verification of population protocols, deciding if a population protocol is well specified, we prove that this problem can be reduced to a mutual reachability question. The existence of homestate problem in PetriNet, it was a long standing open problem. It was proved to be decidable also thanks to the mutual reachability problem by Heike Best and Javier Esparza. So an homestate problem is a configuration such that if you start from the initial configuration, whatever the configuration you reach, it's always possible to come back to that configuration. So deciding there exists such a configuration was an open problem, and they solve it thanks to the mutual reachability problem. With Peter Janschar and Grégoire Sut, we also proved that deciding the reachability set, starting from an initial configuration, if the reachability set is the full state of configurations, so meaning you can reach any possible configuration, this problem is exponential space complete, once again using the mutual reachability result that I provided in Concur. But recently, I received an email from Serge Haddad, and he asked me something about PetriNet, and I say yes, no problem, you can use the mutual reachability result from Concur. But I was not right. So Serge needed something more precise than what it was provided in my Concur paper. So I decided to revisit the problem and to introduce the result that you will find in the proceeding of FSTTCS this year. It's about a more precise notion of small witness for the mutual reachability problem. So I explained that if two configurations are mutually reachable, there exist short runs in between the two configurations. In fact, what Serge was looking for, it was something that explained that the distance between the two configurations, defined the following way. So the distance between two configurations, mutually reachable configuration, is the minimal length of a cycle in the reachability graph that contains the two configurations. And the question of Serge reduce, in fact, was reducible to providing a bound on the distance that is linear somehow with respect to the difference, the Euclidean distance between x and y. And in fact, this is what I provided in the proceedings. I proved that if you have a Petri net, such that all the values that you can, the numbers that you use in your Petri net are bounded by some m. In fact, for every pair of mutual reachable configurations, x and y, the distance between x and y is bounded by the norm of y minus x times a constant, where this constant is just a constant of that form. You see, it's polynomial in m, and the degree is something that is doubly exponential. So there is no way to avoid the doubly exponential that we have here on the dimension, because the problem, the mutual reachability problem, is doubly exponential space, is exponential space. So witness cannot be smaller than doubly exponentially long. And but this the fact also the fact that this distance is bounded by a linear function in y minus x is also optimal, in the sense there is no way, if you want to go from x to y, since you move step by step by adding vectors, there is no way to have a distance that is sublinear. Okay, so this result somehow is optimal with respect to the distance between x and y and the norm of y minus x. So that was the introduction, just how to explain the context of that result. And I will not enter in full details of the proof. You have the proof in the proceeding. I just want to provide you two technical results that can be useful in some other context than just reachability or mutual reachability problem for Petri nets. So we will see. So I will first present a result about the Steinitz constant, and then, if I have time, I will explain some result about extractors. So the Steinitz constant. The Steinitz constant is it's a very nice result. It was there is a paper of one pages that provide the result. So the paper is quite short. But you will see that it's a very important result in the reachability problem of systems manipulating counters. So intuitively, when you have an execution in a system manipulating counters, like a Petri net, and if you want to avoid a negative value, so you remember configuration are vector of natural numbers, so at some point, actions may decrease your counter too much, and you are blocked. There is no way to continue the execution. And usually when you want to decide a reachability problem for a Petri net, the first step is to allow the semantics to go to negative values. Okay, so you try to find an execution and from a configuration X to a configuration Y, and in between the execution, you allow configuration to be negative. And then you are going to reorder somehow your execution in such a way along the execution, you are still above zero. Okay, this is a very simple idea that works well for Petri net, and the Steinitz constant provide a way to reorder. So let's consider this example. You see, I have a sequence of vectors. I add the vectors v1, v2, v3, v4, and so on. And then I use V10, V11, 12, and so on. And I get this value. You see, so somehow I move from this configuration to that configuration by a sequence of vectors. And unfortunately, this vector is maybe too small. Okay, you get to negative values. So you need to reorder. So the question is it possible to reorder this sequence of vectors in a nice way? So when I say nice way, I would like to stay along the direction from given by this total sum, this vector, which is the total sum of the vectors along this. So naturally, you can reorder. You can say, okay, let's first execute v1, then v2, and then v10, this one, and then v3, v4, and v11, okay, and so on. So as you can see, I stay along this direction. And moreover, I progress step by step along this direction. Okay. So for me, this is a nice reordering of the set of vectors. And the question is it always possible to reorder a sequence of vectors such that you do not diverge too much from the total sum of your sequence of vectors. So this is the paper, the one page paper. So if you consider a sequence of vectors v1 vk of real numbers, vector of real numbers, such that the norm of each vector is bounded by 1, and if you make the total sum of this vector, then in fact there always exists a permutation of the vectors such that all the partial sums are not so far from the vector, from the total sum vector. And you see, we progress step by step because it's for every n in between d and k, where k is the number of vectors. We go in the direction v divided by k. So we progress step by step by v divided by k. And the Steinitz constant is in fact what is the best possible value you can put here. And in that paper, they show that d is optimal. Okay, so the dimension of the vector, the value of the dimension is in fact the optimal value in order to be able to reorder a sequence of vectors in such a way you do not diverge from this direction. So in this case, we are in dimension 2, and the distance is no more than 2, okay, in that example. So this Steinitz constant result is very useful to reorder a run in such a way you stay along a direction. But even if you diverge not too much from that direction, maybe you start from something too small on some components. So somehow you would like to extract on your run, on a possible run. So you would like to extract components that are very large somehow. And there is a way to do that based on the notion of extractors, but I skip this part. You can find out extractors technique in the proceedings. Somehow, this is a way to abstract a vector of natural numbers by keeping somehow small values and put apart large values. Okay. Usually it's difficult because if you have a sequence of numbers, maybe each number is not so far from each other. Okay, so it's difficult to separate a set of numbers into small ones and large ones. But in fact, if you provide not just one threshold, but a sequence of thresholds that is called an extractor, there is a way to define this notion of small and big components. So just to conclude, so the main result of the paper is provided in the paper is that result, the fact that the distance is bounded the following way. So you see it's a linear bound in with respect to the Euclidean distance between the two configurations. It's obtained thanks to the Steinitz constant. I would like to thank Mathias Englert and Ronko Lazic for pointing out this result. And it's also based on the notion of extractors plus the usual Rakoff techniques. So if you don't know what is Rakoff techniques, you should have a look at the Rakoff papers from the 19s. That is a very nice paper. I would like to introduce an open question for this slide. It comes from a question from Félix Klatke. A recent question during the presentation of that result, so the fact that the reachability problem for Petrinet is hard for Tower. The question is, usually when you have a problem, you would like to know from which part your problem is difficult. So is it due to the dimension? Is it due to the value of the Petrinet that makes the problem Tower? In fact, if you fix the dimension of a Petrinet, we know that the problem, the reachability problem, is hard for d-13 exponential space. Okay, so the fact that we get tower, the height of the tower, in fact, somehow corresponds to the dimension of your Petrinet. But if you fix the Petrinet, and now you look at the reachability problem for that Petrinet, the question is, what is the complexity of the reachability problem? And this question is linked to the mutual reachability result I provided in the previous slide, because I show that I say the mutual reachability problem is decidable, and in fact the length of a path is linearly bounded with respect to the norm of y minus x. But naturally I put apart the Petrinet, So somehow, it seems reasonable to try to find the complexity of the reachability problem when you fix the PetriNet. And moreover, is it true that the length of the minimal path from a configuration X to a reachable one is always linear in Y minus X? So this problem is open, and there is no way to use what we did recently in order to obtain a lower bound that is not elementary. So maybe it completes the set of conjectures provided by Ronco in his invited talk as a wrong conjecture, but for the moment we don't know, we don't have such a result. Thanks a lot.
Can you use your result to this, to fix the complexity of deciding whether the net is cyclic? It means whether the initial marking is an open state, for example.
So you can decide it in exponential space. Okay, because somehow you can you can write a formula that explains this property using the mutual reachability problem. So, but maybe your question is it exponential space complete? So usually when you look at a problem for a PetriNet, you get some exponential space lower bound quite easily. But for your problem, maybe it's since it is a kind of structural property. And for structural properties, sometimes it's just polynomial time. So maybe this one, I don't know. I don't know.
Yeah, so the 3.
Oh?
D minus the 3.
It's just, in fact, this result, the tower, the fact that the reachability problem is hard for tower is obtained by composing some PetriNets some number of times. And at every composition, we get somehow an exponential on the complexity. We get an exponential blow up. I mean, so the first time the reachability problem for this small PetriNet is exponential time, then it's doubly exponential, three exponential, and so on. And at every step, we add a new dimension, a new counter that is used to check that everything. In fact, we simulate Minsky machine somehow, and we need an extra counter in those compositions. So, but initially, we need some extra counters in order to have this small program that we compose by itself some number of times, and this is why we have the 13. Yes, but it just maybe it's less, maybe it's we don't know.
If you look at the picture, that you get this lower bound, is that conjecture? Can you say something about this conjecture about the minimal path? So is it true that
so in your reduction, we simulate a Minsky machine, a fixed one. But if you take a universal Minsky machine, you can simulate the universal Minsky machine. And in particular, it seems that the reachability problem, when you fix the PetriNet, is D minus 13 or D exponential space if you have some extra counters. But it's not true because somehow in this simulation, we need to start from some number which is larger and larger that is encoded in the PetriNet. So it means that at some point in the reduction, we need a PetriNet such that on one transition, we have a weight that is a number. And such that the complexity of the simulation will be 2 power 2 power 2 of that number. I mean, where the number of towers is the dimension of your PetriNet. And so, we cannot use. I was thinking that it will be possible to use that result in order to obtain complexity also of that form when you fix the PetriNet, but it's not true. We need something else.
Thanks.